possible? And I have a glass of water there, so I can put some water on him.
Yes. You can also put it up
here.
So, follow me, please.
Yeah.
Yes.
So please set the light speed on. So I guess it's about to start my PhD defense. Thank you all for coming. My name is Georgios Dialynas, and I'm originally from Greece. I'm here with you today to defend my PhD thesis. To start with, my PhD thesis is funded from a European Commission and Marie Curie Actions, and is part of a European project called Motorist. The aim of this project, in particular of my PhD, is to understand how humans control and balance a bicycle from a mathematical perspective. So to start with my presentation, first of all, I will present the contents of my presentation. I will explain why I'm conducting this research. So what is the problem that I'm trying to solve? What is the aim of the project? Oh, I will split this aim into two main objectives. I will also explain what are the tools that I developed, so what kind of experimental setups I developed in order to capture some data. I will also present the experimental procedure, and I will also later on present some preliminary results. I will discuss it with you all, and I will make some conclusions. In the end, as a researcher, I will basically explain what is the impact of this research to the society. Of course, we are scientists and we want to know what will be the impact of our work, so why we're doing this to help the society. In the end, I will acknowledge, of course, the people that helped me during my PhD here in TU Delft. So what is the problem? The problem is that basically cycling fatalities. So according to the European Road Safety Observatory, in 2016, about 2,000 cyclists were killed in road accidents through the European Union. These cycling-related fatalities have increased from in 2007 from 6% to 2016 at 8%. If we look close into the figures, it will be revealed that these accidents are so-called single-vehicle accidents, meaning that the cyclist just simply lose his balance, steering or roll balance, if you want to say it this way, and falls into the ground. So what can we do about this is we can have a mathematical approach. We can undertake experiments in order mainly to fulfill two objectives. The first objective is how we actively control a bicycle. Of course, we want to understand this from a neuromechanics or a biomechatronics engineering perspective, but we also want to identify how the stiffness and dynamic properties of our body contribute to the riding process. So next, what is important is to create a rider control model based on realistic rider control responses, and this can be done using a mathematical process called system identification. So what system identification basically means is that We don't know exactly how the human controller, so how we control the bicycle, but what we do know is that for a given input signal, so for a given stimulus, for a given disturbance into the system, we can monitor the output response. And by knowing the input signal and the output responses, we can, let's say, build a model of the rider. Of course, we are scientists, and we have to validate this model using naturalistic riding data. So how we control the bicycle? Basically, we control the bicycle using our senses. So what we use is, of course, sorry for this. So what we are using is our eyes. We are using our eyes mainly to obtain information related to the heading of the bicycle, forward velocity of the bicycle, and other states. But we are also using the vestibular loop, which is a sensor inside our ear, which gives information regarding the rotational accelerations that our body experiences during the riding process, but also the translational accelerations that we experience. We also have the proprioceptive loop that you see on the top of this figure, and this basically sensory input consists of two sensors. We have the Golgi tendon organs, which give information to our brain regarding the force that we receive in our hands. So in this case, the steer torque feedback that we receive through the handlebars of the bicycle, and we have the muscle spindles, which give information regarding the angular position of our handlebars, but also the angular rate. So the main question here is, of course, what is going inside our head? What is the control algorithm that we are using to control the bicycle? And what will happen if we cancel the steering sensation, the haptic sensation? Will we be able to control the bicycle or not? To find the answer to these questions, I developed from scratch a steer-by-wire bicycle. Steer-by-wire, I will explain later what it means, but what you need to know right now is that it's a bicycle which is capable of monitoring all of the bicycle states and control input. So we can monitor how much what's the roll angle, what's the steer angle, what is the torque that the rider applies. And as I said here, steer-by-wire means basically that there is no mechanical connection between the handlebars and the fork. We have replaced this connection with sensors capable of measuring both the steer, the handlebar angle, but also the fork angle, and two digital controllers. The controllers basically are responsible to generate the handlebar torque feedback that we receive, but also to steer the fork and allow the rider to control the bicycle. So how we can capture how the rider is controlling the bicycle? So what we can do is we can, let's say, disturb. We can disturb the balance of the rider by pulling him from the side with the rope, and by measuring the force that we apply and knowing what are the steer control actions, we can capture some data in order to model the rider. So the main question is here how we can model the rider as a controller. What you see here is a high-level overview of the bicycle rider system. On top, you have a block which represents mathematically the bicycle. It has as an input the steer torque that the rider control block applies, and it gives us an output the bicycle states. The bicycle states are fitted into the rider model. The rider model is the block indicated with red color here, and it consists of mainly four control elements. We have a delay block, we have a predictor block, a pure gain block, and a neuromuscular dynamics block. What does the delay block does in this case is it gives delays to the states that are coming into the rider model, and these delays are based on the length of the neurons. So imagine that from the moment you perceive information from your eyes or from your vestibular loop until the signal goes into your brain, you have constant delays. So using this block, we can simulate these delays. These delays are fitted into a predictor. What does the predictor does is it uses the internal control model principle, which happens in the cerebellum of our brain, in order to feed forward the states in time. So we have a mathematical model of the system dynamics that we control, and we feed forward the states ahead of time in order to compensate not only the delays that are coming, the delay of the states that are coming as an input, but also the noise that we perceived through our sensor inputs. On top of that, this information, which is the better state estimation, which is coming as an output of the predictor, is given to the gain block. The gain block consists, in this case, of mainly six gains, and the output of this block is the neural input. The neural input is the output that is produced, so it's the neural impulse, which is produced from the primary cortex of our brain. This neural impulse is given to the neuromuscular dynamics of the human rider in order to apply a control torque and steer. So this is how we can model the rider as a control system. And this brings me to the discussion conclusion section of the first objective. So what we have to mention here that for the steer-by-wire bicycle, we made the bicycle which does not have mechanical connection between the handlebars and the fork. We replaced this connection with sensors and actuators and two smart controllers. And using this technology, we test this technology in practice, and we found out that the participants did not feel that they were not riding a mechanical steer bicycle. And this was basically perceived for steering frequencies below 3 Hz. In the future, I recommend to optimize further these two controllers by adding a feed-forward control element into both controllers. And of course, this error, the tracking error, so the error between the handlebars and the fork, can be further optimized. Regarding the rider control model that we developed, what we found out is that, of course, we kind of expected this. When we add delays into the system becomes unstable. The predictor control sim, which, as I said before, it's happening in the cerebellum, is really important, not only to compensate these delays, but also to compensate the noise that is coming through our sensory channels. Another question that we have was regarding torque feedback. Is it important or not? The answer is that torque feedback, so what you feel through the Golgi tendon organs, is important. Specifically, it's more important at low forward speeds. So we see higher degradation there when we cancel the torque feedback in the handlebars. This is basically of significant importance, especially for new safety systems. I will explain later what this means. The second objective is how the dynamics, the passive dynamics of how the passive dynamics, so how the intrinsic and reflexic properties of our body contribute to the riding process. So what we basically need to know is what are the forces that the rider applies in the handlebars, footpegs, and also seat. And for this reason, we developed a unique instrumented bicycle mock-up. It's a bicycle mock-up which is equipped with strain gauges, so we can measure the forces that the rider applies in all directions and all bicycle interfaces. And we can also monitor the acceleration in the platform base, so in this platform base. This is a motion platform, so it generates motions in all 6 degrees of freedom. But we can also measure the rider force responses in terms of acceleration, the acceleration of the rider in the upper body. This is important because basically what we want to identify here is the so-called apparent mass. What is the apparent mass? Is the ratio of the applied force divided with the acceleration in all the interfaces. But what we also need to know is how our upper body moves and how our spinal column deforms, if you want to say it this way. And for this reason, we measure also the acceleration between the infrastellar nodes of the spinal column and also the seat of the rider. Here you can see an actual video of the perturbation experiments. On the left, you see the rider moving in the vertical direction. On the middle, you see the rider moving fore and aft, so in the longitudinal direction. And on the left corner, you see the rider body swaying, so you see lateral movements of the platform. What we get out of this is basically, as I told you, a lot, many transfer functions. So we get the apparent mass transfer functions and the transmissibility transfer functions. What is important here to mention is that in this plot, we only see the C2-Sternum transmissibility, and this is done due to lack of time. I will not explain a lot how what we see in these plots. I will mainly refer to this in my conclusions. But what you need to know is here that by measuring the gain of the signal, we monitor how, let's say, a gain of one indicates that the upper body is moving exactly as the platform. The phase indicates basically how ahead we are of the motion or how behind we are of the motion, in simple words. And coherence indicates how linear we respond to the disturbance. So this is what you see in these figures. You see on the top plot for the longitudinal motions, they call it surge. For the lateral motion, they call it sway. You see the upper body dynamics. And for the vertical, you see, let's say, the vertical dynamics of the spinal column. So let's move to the discussion of this section. We create a mock-up, which was successful in measurement of all the apparent mass with high level of accuracy. What I recommend to do in the future, make this instrumented bicycle mock-up with adjustable dimensions, and this will allow to the participants to sit in a different riding posture. This is particularly important to see what will be the effect into the apparent mass and transmissibility functions in order to build, let's say, a more optimized model. Regarding the biomechanical responses, what we notice is that even we perturb the rider in one direction, the rider applies forces in all 3D axes. We see some interaction between the vertical and longitudinal motion, but we see totally different dynamics for the sway motion, meaning that we have basically two different systems. Resonant frequencies, if I can say it this way, I will refer it as resonant-like peaks because I'm not 100% sure if these are resonant frequencies, are higher in the vertical direction compared to the longitudinal. And in the the sway motion, there was no resonance. However, we see a response close to an inverted pendulum, and we also see actively the rider to control his trunk, meaning that for most frequencies and perturbation magnitudes, the rider cannot be represented by a mass. So we need to have a parametric model to understand better the dynamic contribution of the rider to the rider bicycle system. This is the main conclusion here. So before I finish my presentation, as I said in the beginning, I will refer to what, in my belief, is the impact of my research to the society. So now, by having a bicycle model combined with a rider model, we can do as many simulations as we want. So we can understand better cycling falls. We can apply this knowledge in order to improve the existing training techniques, but we can also assess the handling properties of new bicycle designs in a computerized way. Of course, as I said, the main objective here is to prevent bicycle falls, and by having a control algorithm, a rider control algorithm, we can create active balance control systems, so active balance bicycles and motorcycles, something that you will see in the near future from big OEMs, like you will see it as steer assist systems, and this is something that I'm extremely proud of. So this technology will be applied in the upcoming years. So as you can imagine, the journey of the PhD takes 4 to 5 years time, and there were actually a lot of people that helped me in this research. First of all, I would like to thank my partner, Elisabeth Kotsi, for standing next to me and motivating during the tough moments. My family, so my mother and my father, Mikhail Dialynas and Glikeria Delivasi, and of course my brother, Nikos Dialynas, for his support even during tough moments. I would like really acknowledge all of the partners of the Motorist project, including the industrial partners, but also the academic partners, for giving me the opportunity to work in such a big international project. Of course, I would like to thank my daily supervisor, Aaron Schwab, and Rieder Happe for his guidance, and all of my students. But in particular, I would like to thank two of my students. So Christos Christoforidis, for his work on the rider control modeling, and Jelle Welling de Haan for his help analyzing the biomechanical responses or the transfer functions. So this is the end of my presentation. I would like to thank you all for being here and supporting me through my PhD defense. Thanks a lot. Okay, let's now wait for the... I think we have about 10 minutes for the committee members to come in and examine you. I don't know if the crowd has to ask some questions,
no.
But I think it's not allowed. So
it's allowed, but we have to take care of you, so you may need a little bit of
okay.
Rest.
Yes. Thank you.
See you later.
Yes.
Ik open de zitting van de commissie ter beoordeling van het proefschrift en de stellingen van Georgios Dialynas, mechanical engineer. De verdediging zal in het Engels worden gevoerd. I request the promovendus to go to the lectern. A warm welcome for all of you at the public defense by the candidate of the dissertation entitled An Experimental Approach into the Quantification of Steering and Balance Behavior of Bicyclists. The Board of Doctorates of the TU Delft has installed a committee to evaluate the thesis and propositions. The committee will have a debate with the candidate in public, and it is an honor to present to you the members of the committee. First of all, I would like to extend a very warm welcome to each of them. The committee members are Dr. Moore from the University of California, Davis, the USA. Welcome. Thanks for joining. Then Dr. Escalona Franco from the University of Sevilla, Spain. Also a warm welcome. Then Professor Pirini from the University of Florence, Italy. Thank you for joining. Professor Dosa from Chalmers University in Sweden. Welcome. And then all the other members are from the TU Delft. First of all, Professor Abink from TU Delft. Welcome. The co-promoter, who is participating online, Dr. Schwab. And the promoter, Dr. Hape, who is sitting left from me. Thank you all for participating in this academic ceremony. And my name is Professor van Keulen, and I'm from the Faculty of Mechanical Engineering, and it is a very great pleasure for me to chair this session on behalf of the Rector Magnificus. Having said this, I would like to start the opposition, and I would like to give the floor to Dr. Moore. Dr. Moore, could you start your debate with the candidate?
For the promovendus, welcome. Thanks for having us. I'm very excited to debate with you. I enjoyed your thesis quite a lot, and it brought back lots of memories to some similar works that I've done, and I'm excited to get to work with your inventions and experimental apparatus in the future here. Monsieur Director, I would like to start with proposition number one.
Right, promovendus, could you please be so kind to read proposition number one?
My name is Director. Proposition number one states existing steering stabilizers that are primarily in motorcycles might have a negative impact if they are used on bicycles during the challenging moments of a drastic crosswind due to high resistance of the bicycle steering.
Dr. Moore, we are very curious to hear your question.
Yes, so so-called steer dampers are added to many modern motorcycles, and they cause some effect on your steering behavior. Curious, what effect do they in fact cause, and why do you think it would be problematic for a bicyclist?
Sir Helinde, opponent, thank you for your question. In page 14 of my thesis, section 2.6, line 3, you can see that in the conclusion section, it is stated that the bicycle steered to the direction of the wind. In my belief, adding steering resistance might cause a delay to the system, so it will cause a delay to the steering to the wind behavior, and this might also increase the control effort. Proof of that is... on page 58 of my thesis, I think it's chapter five, where we assessed the impact of haptic on and haptic off configurations. You can see that for the haptic off case, there is a plot. So in figure 5.5, we compare the delay that we experience when we have steering feedback on and steering feedback off. In the steering feedback off configuration, where we do not have to counteract the moment of inertia and dynamics of the bicycle, we see that we have a faster steering response. And this response is faster by 18 milliseconds. So to summarize my answer, this led me to believe that adding damping to the handlebars will also have a negative effect into the steering to the fall behavior.
Okay, thank you for that response. I find that adequate. And I'll move on to another question. You mentioned, you brought us chapter 5 and the haptic on and haptic off scenario, which I think is a very interesting piece of the puzzle. One thing that I gathered from chapter 5, it seemed that it implied that when thinking about steer angle and steer torque as feedback variables in the system, that the steer torque or the haptic feedback is not necessary to balance the bicycle successfully. But when you move on to modeling this system in chapter 6, you show that removing not having steer torque with the time delays built into the model, in fact, can't happen. So it seems a little contradictory between 5 and 6. Can you comment on that contradiction, and which one you think may be correct, if at all, or what the meaning in there is?
Sehr geehrter Opponent, thank you for your question. In my belief, this is a very good question, actually. So I was looking forward to defend it. I have to say here that in chapter 5, we examined two conditions, haptics on and haptics off, with haptic off meaning switching off the motor which generates the steering dynamics. The way the humans perceive feedback are through the proprioceptive loop, and more specific, we have the Golgi tendon organs which give information regarding the torque feedback, and we have the muscle spindles that give information regarding steer angle and steer rate. So what happens in this scenario is that even though we cancel the torque feedback and we perceive feedback only due to the inertia and frictional properties of the motor connected to the handlebars, the rider, we didn't see any degradation from the varies accounted for. So we assumed initially that torque feedback is not really important, and that position, let's say position control, is more significant here. But later on, in chapter 6, when we modeled the rider as a controller and we had the torque feedback as an input to the controller model, and we totally disconnect the feedback, we saw different results. So meaning that these are mainly three different configurations that we examined. We examined haptics on, so feeling feedback in the handlebars, haptics off, feeling only the inertial properties connected to the handlebars and frictional damping, but not the dynamics that are coming to our hands. But in the model, we totally cancel out the whole torque feedback concept. So that's why we see degradation in the fitting. So to summarize my answer, these are three conditions, and I decide to explain them in chapter 6 as with feedback, without feedback, and with totally disconnected tether feedback, just to have a more clear statement there.
So you have those three scenarios, and I don't know if I saw the connection there to the haptic on, haptic off experiments. Are there, do those one of those three scenarios elucidate why steer torque didn't seem important in the first experiments?
In the real world experiments with haptics off, there was no way to cancel totally the feedback coming through the inertial properties of the handlebars. And so what we can do here is we can apply negative stiffness and redo the experiments to be totally soon for the claim of Chapter 6. But as you can imagine, this is really hard to do it, not only from a control perspective, but it's also very hard to be approved from the ethical committee of the Delft University of Technology. Another thing that we can do to make this claim more solid is to, as you suggested when you were reviewing my thesis, and this is something that I also extensively thought during my PhD, it's to totally take out the handlebars of the bicycle and connect a PlayStation gamepad or even a small keyboard. But again, the ethical committee might restrict these experiments. So these are my thoughts regarding Chapter 5 and 6. And we have to be very extremely careful, since we are all scientists, regarding the impact that this has. So I prefer to, let's say, have two claims which maybe conflict partially with each other, but in my belief, I clearly state in my thesis why I believe that these claims are valid, and I'm leaning towards, let's say, I suggest new experiments to validate these thoughts. Thank you.
Thank you. That is very clear. Maybe, Director, do I have more time for a question?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Okay. This also regards the models in Chapter 6. How generalizable do you think your human controller is to specific riders? Does the variance in human control behavior have large, small, or no bearing on understanding human control behavior and balancing, or the applicability of these findings to future things?
Sehr geehrte Opponent, would you mind explaining the question a little bit further? So I didn't clearly understand what you are asking.
Yeah, the first part was, how generalizable do you think your human controller is to specific riders? You arrived at your controller from a mean rider. Obviously, people have some variation in control, and I guess I'm curious, what is the importance of having a handle on the specificness of specific rider's control, or is a mean controller suitable for use in future work?
Sehr geehrte Opponent, thank you for your question. I would like to point you out in a specific plot in my thesis in Chapter 6. Please allow me to take a look and point you out in the exact plot. In the page 76 of my thesis, Figure 6.8, what we did here is we took the mean response of the rider and we tried to identify which of the individual responses was close to the mean. So we basically took the median response of the rider to do rider control identification. So just to be clear here, it was not the mean. How applicable are my results to different, let's say, rider behavior? I have to say that the data that we have, even though it's the first time that we collect so much data for so many participants on the open road, I feel that we need to explore towards and maybe have more than 100 participants to have a good statistical indication of how well my controller, let's say, predicts human behavior. The thing that I can assure you, and I think it's a valid claim to say, is that first of all, this is the first time a rider control model which uses different delays for each sensory path is implemented. And on top of that, it's the first time, although known in the neuroscience field, referred from Miaul, that the cerebellum of the rider is basically that the cerebellum of our brain holds two Smith predictions, and due to the lack of, due to the inability of the Smith predictions to control unstable open loop systems, we have to build a so-called sensory delay reafferent optimal predictor. So the controller realistically follows the logic that the human has to control a bicycle, and this is my belief is the first time that has been actually implemented on the bicycle, would be the model able to, let's say, control a bicycle when the system dynamics change. So if, for example, we cancel the feedback, would be the model able to, let's say, correct the state estimates. I would like to point you out in another figure of my thesis.
Can you conclude your
yes.
answer?
Yes. So regarding human behavior, if it can predict human behavior of many riders, we need a bigger statistical data. If the control logic is correct, yes, in my belief, it's the first time which someone models this accurately the rider.
Okay, thank you very much. Dr. Moore, are you satisfied with this debate?
I am satisfied. Thank you. Warren.
Thank you very much. Then I would like to give the floor to Dr. Escolona Franco.
Mr. Director, thank you very much. Vade promovendus. I have enjoyed a lot reading your thesis, and I would like to start by congratulating you for this nice piece of work that combines modeling and the experimental pattern. I think it's very important. Nowadays, not that many people do that research on experimental mechanical engineering. I want to start by asking you questions about chapter 3, about the calculation of the apparent mass and seat to sternum functions, frequency functions that you have done in this chapter. At the beginning, when I read that, I thought, because you're right in your thesis, that the rider's body consists of inertial and viscoelastic bodies. I thought that you wanted to include the rider as another set of bodies into the model, but you didn't do that. Actually, my first question is quite general, and is that I don't really know exactly what is the purpose of these functions. What do you want to do with them? Because afterwards, in chapter number six, when you develop the rider's control, you actually, it seems that you don't use this information.
Yes. Sir Helinde opponent, thank you for your question. Thank you for pointing out this. This is a really good question. So the objective of chapter 3 is to understand how humans control a bicycle from a biomechanical engineering perspective. The two indicators that we use mainly in this research are the apparent mass and transmissibility functions. And of course, the final goal here is to model passively the rider and add this to the existing mathematical model called Carvalho-Whipple model. As you point out correctly, there is in chapter 6, and it's clearly mentioned, that the roll angle predicted as an output of the model did not match the roll angle that we noticed in the real world. And this means that there is something missing regarding the bicycle model. And as you pointed out, I did not model the rider as a biomechanical model, if you want to say it this way. And this is something that will be done of the future. Why it was not done is because, in my belief, we need also to identify impedance responses to have a more clear view of how the rider is controlling the bicycle. So what are the stiffness and dynamic properties of his body? And then, of course, we can model the rider. If you ask me how I will model the rider, I will add a horizontal mass-spring damper system and an inverted pendulum on the top with some stiffness and damping properties, like it was done before in Jason Moore thesis in page 56, if I remember well. This is already a known issue, and this is how I will do it in the future.
Thank you. Now, very specific question here. If you go to figure number 3.7 of your thesis, the situs ternum transmissibility function in the sway direction starts at a frequency of 0.17 hertz, that is actually very slow, at a value of 3. Actually, you point out in your thesis that there is no resonance in this function, and it is true, but for me it's even more strange, weird, that that function starts at 3, because by definition the transmissibility should start at 1. And you didn't comment much on this on your thesis, so I would like you to ask you, how is it possible that when you go really, really slow, the acceleration of the sternum is 3 times the acceleration of the set?
Sir Helinde opponent, thank you for your question. Regarding your question, first of all, before we monitor the ride response, we introduced one fade in and one fade out period in the signal. This signal is already implemented in trunk postular control studies. A study I can point out is Van Trunen study. And the way, the reason we have this fade in and fade out periods is to activate the dynamics of our system at a very low frequency. Although humans below 1 hertz tend to act voluntarily, and this is something we cannot avoid, and this is something that is also pointing out from the coherence. So we see that the system is linear, and from the coherence significant level for a t-test 1, confidence interval, we are not sure exactly if these samples are totally different from zero, meaning that we are not totally sure what will, what we see in this plot. And this is the reason why I also plot the coherence significance level. So if the frequency is below the coherence significance level, it can be also noise. But you are totally right. If you compare the apparent mass and transmissibility functions, you will see also that the upper body has 3 times more accelerations than the one, the magnitude is 3 times higher than the one we apply. This is because we are actively controlling our trunk and pelvis, and we are using the intrinsic and reflexic responses of the pelvis to apply forces opposed to the direction of the perturbation signal in the seat. So this is something that also came out from the study and has never been explained before. Thank you.
Stability of the bicycle is actually not important. And this goes kind of against previous work of your group in reference number 16, in which it is stated that the haptic steering feedback of the rider control is actually important. So at this point, Menier Director, I would like to question on proposition number 6.
By the candidate, can you please read proposition number 6?
My dear director, proposition number 6 states, steering feedback is important for balancing and maneuver bicycle.
So the floor is yours again, Dr. Franco.
Well, at the end, I don't know what to conclude. It is not clear for me. Is it important or is it not important?
Sir Helinde opponent, I would like to thank you again for the question. I have to point out that this has also partially been explained due to the questioning of Sir Helinde opponent Jason Moore. I have to explain maybe more clearly that there are three conditions: haptics on, haptics off, and the torque feedback loop totally disconnected only in the model. So only in the modeling approach we can for sure claim that there is no feedback information coming through the handlebars, because even though in our experiments we cancel the haptic feedback, so we cancel the forces that are applied from the front wheel to our hands, if you want to say it this way, we cannot cancel out some feedback that we have due to the friction of the gearhead motors which are attached with the handlebar, and also inertia of the components. As I said before, we can do the experiments again with negative stiffness to totally cancel out this sensation. So to summarize, there are three different conditions. Haptics on is with haptic feedback on the handlebars and the motor of the handlebars activated. Haptic off is by switching off the motor, but you have some perceived feedback from the inertia properties of the handlebars and friction, viscous friction of the motor which is attached to the handlebars. And torque feedback totally disconnected is only in the model, and it's only can be at this state done to validate the claim that haptic feedback is important. I hope this answers your question.
Dr. Franco, are you satisfied with these answers?
Yes, I am. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Then I would like to give the floor to Professor Pierini, please.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam Director, and by the promovendor. I'm very glad to be here today as an opponent in your defense. And I also enjoy very much the reading. This is, as already stated by my colleagues before, I was very, especially very happy to see the big amount of work you have done the experimental side by performing your test, but also by developing your own bike and your system. So congratulations from my side for this very nice work. Coming to the first question, I would like to start from chapter 2, where you have studied the effect of the crosswind on the lateral dynamics of the bicycle. However, there are other types of perturbation that can affect these type of dynamics. I mentioned, for instance, perturbation that comes to the directly to the wheel, especially the front wheel. Or, for instance, perturbation that comes to the handlebar. You may have, for instance, when you have several cyclists riding side by side, they can touch together and they can have some impact on the handlebar. So I would like to discuss with you the possibility of extending your work also to this type of application.
Jorge Linde, opponent. Thank you for your question. I was actually looking forward for this question, since I know that you are one of the leaders in this field. This is mainly due to your knowledge and patent regarding viscous damping systems for motorcycles. To answer your questions, I would like to refer to semi-oscillations, which are oscillations of the steering shaft, if you want to say it this way. Due to in previous research conducted by Arendt Schwab, we saw that these semi-oscillations occur at frequencies from 0 Hz up to 7 Hz and are extremely dangerous, as you point out. We also, on the other hand, have rear wobble oscillations, so the rear of the bicycle frame can also oscillate, and I guess these motions are somehow connected. So if I want to extend the findings of my thesis, I will strongly recommend in the future safety systems to add an electric motor or integrate an electric motor inside the head tube of the bicycle, so we can create the fork shaft of the bicycle, we can make it a permanent magnet, and we can add electromagnetic damping when the steering frequencies, when the handlebars become oscillatory. So we need basically an absolute encoder to measure the position, and we also need an electric motor to damp out these oscillations. This might be particularly important for both competitive racing of bicycles and also motorcycles. To summarize, although we have steering dampers in motorcycles, these systems are active and they cannot change its properties, for different velocities. And when you ride a bicycle or a motorcycle, you need to have a more compliant steering at low speeds. So this will also be an added value of such a system.
Thank you. Thank you. I would like to move to a more specific question, which is on chapter 4, I think it's on page 45, where you mentioned that in your steering system you have some backlash, which is, I would say, pretty small, because it's smaller than 1 degree. But I wonder if during the experimental testing, the riders experience or could feel this backlash, and if this has had effect in the testing.
Jorge Linde, opponent, thank you for your question. I have extensively thought about the backlash on my system. There are two approaches here. We can either use harmonic drives, which have zero backlash, as they call it, or we can use planetary gearheads, which have some play. In my case, the play of the planetary gears is 0.80 degrees for the servo motor attached to the handlebars and 0.80 degrees for the servo motor attached to the fork. In total, if you rotate the handlebars and the fork, you have a backlash of 1.6 degrees. This backlash, in terms of control theory, can be modeled as a dent pad. But what I find out is that when you tune properly the gains of your controller, you don't need actually to take into account this backlash, so the system does not oscillate. Of course, if there is more mechanical play, the system starts oscillating. So regarding your question, is the perceived play was not apparent in the during the riding process, but of course, when we install the motors, you can really sense the backlash of the system. Why I did not use harmonic drives? Because in driving simulation conference in 2017 in Stuttgart, Germany, they showed that when you increase the reduction rate of harmonic drives, they might cause the system to lock. And I want to avoid locking of the handlebars when you can imagine you're riding the bicycle in real conditions and not in a simulation environment. And this is the reason why I conclude my choice to planetary gearheads. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Very convincing answer to my question. I have another question still on the same chapter, which is about the gain of the PD controller. I think it's 4.5, and you mentioned that the gains that you have selected are somehow unrealistic. And they are also determined experimentally. So my question is, I wonder whether you think it is possible for future application to develop a model that can help you to determine the gains value without the need to, determine them from experimental testing.
Jorge Linde, opponent. Thank you for your question. As you can imagine, when we try to model a mechanical system, there are some assumptions that we make. Regarding the assumptions that I made when I used the Whipple bicycle model to tune theoretically in the pure computerized way the gains of my controller, is I found out that the model does not incorporate friction between the handlebars and fork. So as you can imagine, this has an impact in tuning the controllers. Also on top of that, there is no backlash in the system. Even when you extend it, the model that I used does not have a backlash. So you cannot clearly see if you let's say, switch between different reduction gearheads, what will be the effect in the gains or if the system will oscillate. So a way to improve this is, of course, to add damping in the extended version of the Whipple bicycle model, so the version which has the fork disconnected from the handlebars, and also to model the backlash of the system. I would like to point out in the conclusion section, because as you can see from the torque feedback, is that above 3 Hz we have a plateau, and this is due to the finite stiffness and damping properties of the handlebar controllers. So in the future, we must find a better way to generate feedback for higher frequencies, and this can be done with feed-forward control techniques. Thank you.
Thank you. Madam Director, if I still have time, I would like to question proposition number 7.
There's time, so if you can read proposition number 7.
My dear Director, proposition number 7 states, a virtual reality bicycle simulator might be used as a balance and motor function rehabilitation system with further objective measurements of balance ability of the patients.
Please, Professor Pirini.
Yeah, well, I think a very important proposition, and I would like to discuss with you the possible application for the measurements of the balance ability of people that may have been impaired by some reasons. Yeah.
Hoher Linde Oponet, thank you for your question. Before I start my question, I would like to explain how we balance a bicycle from a mathematical perspective. So what we do to balance a bicycle is the bicycle can be modeled as an inverted pendulum. So when we roll to the left, we also steer to the left to move the support point behind this, under the center of mass. So mathematically, our brain is trained also to control a bicycle, and also when we are walking, we are controlling our body in the same way. So we are moving our feet under the support point of the center of mass. What we can do with this kind of simulator, which at the moment is fixed-based, is we can virtually tilt the horizon. By tilting the horizon, we can create the illusion that the bicycle is rolling over. And this way, through the visual cues, we can train again the motor neurons for balancing. An objective measure that we can take for rehabilitation will be basically how much torque the rider applies, how fast this torque is applied, and what is the response time to reduce the roll state from the current state to zero. Thank you.
So are you satisfied with these answers?
I'm fully satisfied.
Thank you so much. You. Professor Doza, could you continue the opposition?
Of course. Bande promovendus, I was impressed by your work. It is an impressive amount of work, and I really enjoy reading the thesis, and you did quite a bit of experimental and methodological contributions. However, I would like to have a question on the relevance of your work. If you start reading your thesis in chapter 1, the first thing you find is a problem statement, which is very appropriate. And you talk about cycling safety as a problem you want to address. By the time you read all the theses, very interesting, you get to the conclusions. And in the conclusions, you don't mention cycling safety. So my question to you is, what is your contribution to cycling safety?
Jorge Linde Oponent, thank you for your question. I think when I revised my thesis, I also added cycling safety in the discussion and conclusion section of my thesis. So you can check maybe again the revised version of my thesis, if you'd be so kind. On top of that, what is the contribution of my thesis to cycling safety? I can assure you that, as I said before to Hocherlinde opponent Jason Moore, this is the first time, of course, someone does this detailed work and shows how the actual apparent mass transfer functions of the rider are in all three directions, in all translation motions, which has an impact in modeling the rider and understanding better role stabilization. On top of that, what we can do with this model is we can, as I said, it's a more accurate version of a previous model, so we can run computer simulations and we can assess cycling safety by understanding, for example, as I did before, what will be the impact of crosswind on cycling safety, but also what will be the contribution of the passive behavior of the rider to the stability of the bicycle. Of course, if we move one step further and model the passive dynamics of the rider.
Professor Dosa, we cannot hear you.
Of course, I was muted. Let's move to another question. What I would like to question now is the ecological validity of some of the results. And what I would like is, if you can please look at the figure. There are two figures, figure 3.1A and B. Of course, in chapter 3, and they present your test rig that doesn't look like a normal bicycle, and then they present your participant that doesn't really look like a cyclist. So I was wondering if you could comment how this mismatch, which of course is not lack of precision necessarily, is probably the best you could do, would impact the validity of your results when you want to extend them to the real world.
Hocherlinde, the opponent, thank you for your questioning. The bicycle frame is based on a city bicycle called Batavos Broser, 54 centimeters. The basic geometry that we use to design this bicycle mock-up is the ridge dimension to the handlebars, which is clearly stated in the paper, and the stack height of the handlebars, which is also clearly stated in Chapter 3. These dimensions correspond to a city bicycle, as I said, a Stadsfietsen, as they call it here in the Netherlands, which gives an upper body position of around 30 degrees, an upper body inclination. I don't know from the photograph why it does not appear like it's more upwards, but in my belief, if you visit the bicycle lab and measure on its own, you will validate my measurements. On top of that, regarding the frame geometry, we also make the assumption that the footbacks of the rider are just straight tubes, and we did this basically because we wanted to have a comparison of the leg behavior between the right and left handlebar side, so we want to have a symmetrical, let's say, pedaling position, if you want to say it this way. So how this body position will affect the apparent mass and transmissibility measurements? If you look into the literature, there are studies that evaluate the effect of upper body inclination basically for cars, and they call it, I think, concussion seat positions where they have the hands in the steering wheel, or they incline the upper torso more, so they incline, they have their foot either on the gas pedals or the foot on the floor. So all of these have an impact not only on the dynamics of the system, but as you can imagine, on the resonant frequencies. That's why I also tried in this case to take a city bicycle and also find participants with the same anthropometric characteristics. For future studies, I recommend to make the frame dimensions adjustable so we can really explore more what will be the impact, as you clearly mentioned, of the new sitting postures. Thank you.
Thank you. Madam Director, do I have time for one more question, or should we move forward?
No, you have still time for a question.
Okay. So I would like to ask one last question about the Chapter 8, where you propose the design for a bicycle simulator. And of course, this is very interesting. And again, there is a figure there that shows your setup. And I mean, it's a simulator, nobody's surprised. Of course, again, figure 8.3. Again, that doesn't look quite like a bike. It's very close, but it's not exactly like a bike. And then you use a virtual environment. As you know, driving simulators are very common, and they've been used for a lot of applications. And by now we know that there are things for which we can use these simulators, for instance, for looking at reaction time, and other things where we cannot trust the driving simulator for. Typically, if you want to look at the braking profile of a driver, you cannot trust how it would look like in the driving simulator. And in our driving simulator, sometimes we even have kinematics, because the simulators can move, and your bike cannot. So, of course, this is not a criticism. All simulation would be an approximation. But do we have any clue for which things, or for which application, this simulator could be a good asset, and for which application we may want to stay away from the simulator because we may be misled by the results?
So this is a very extensive question, but can you give a compact answer?
My new director, I will be more than happy to address the question.
No, in a compact way.
In a compact way, yes. Regarding Hoherlinde opponent, regarding the frame geometry, the haptic steering device is attached to the prismatic joint, so we can move the handlebars back and forth, and the shaft is telescopic, so we can move the handlebars up and down. This means that we can obtain reach to handlebar geometry stack height of different bicycle designs. So the figure might not be a good illustration, but you can really quickly adjusting with the levers the geometry. The bicycle simulator at the moment runs on a car-like stable model, so does not clearly represent the dynamics of the real bicycle. This is something that Jason Moore and Professor and Aaron Swab is working towards. So at the moment it's fixed based, which means that we also have motion sickness due to the projection of the states in the virtual environment, but not sensing them in the physical environment. I recommend for this to place the simulator on a hexapod, on the top of a hexapod. Applications. Right now, we can only do some studies so we can see how the bicycles will interact with other road users, but we cannot really do rider control notification experiments. We can also use it as a first step as a rehabilitation system, as I mentioned in my proposition. But maybe this will be a more high fidelity model.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Doza. So I would like to give the floor to Professor Abink.
Yes, unmuted. Waarde promovendus, first of all, my congratulations as well to you for this very nice piece of work. You can be proud, and your supervisor family as well. As you may or may not know, I contributed to the research leading to the release of the first gear-by-wire system by Nissan 10 years ago now. So I personally know many of the complexities involved in this research domain, and I commend you on investigating this approach for bicycle riding, creating and experimenting with a steer-by-wire bicycle. It's such a great platform, I think. So actually, I would like to follow up my my questioning by follow up on the question of my colleague, Professor Dotza. And so with you, is to change the relationship between angles and torques to actually help the rider and perhaps, improve traffic safety. And so could I ask you to think with me what options you might consider in terms of changing relationships between angles and torques now afforded by your steer-by-wire system to help safety?
Professor Abink, a part of your question was blocked by the system. So I would like to request the promovendus to indicate what he missed.
Yeah, so I actually missed the question. So would you mind repeating the question shortly?
Yes, I will. Okay. Do you hear me?
Yes, we hear you.
Yes.
Okay, good. It's incredible. All this time, no problem, and now I have trouble with the Wi-Fi here. So my question was, with your steer-by-wire system, you can now investigate possibilities to change relationships between angles and torques to help the rider and improve traffic safety, perhaps. What options would you consider?
Jorge Lindo Bonet, thank you for your question. The first thing that I will consider is removing the counter-steering. This is something that is suggested in the literature from Marumo and Nagai. In chapter six, in chapter four, I think it's line six, I point out to the literature. Although this has not been experimentally validated, it might be a good approach. On top of that, as I state in chapter five, plot 5.2, if I'm not mistaken, the reduce of the haptic of the steering feedback might be beneficial because the steering responses might be faster. On top of that, what we can explore is neuroplasticity of the brain, so we can also explore reverse steering. So we can steer with the handlebars counterclockwise, and we can apply to the fork an anti-clockwise motion to see if our brain is able to adapt immediately, which previous experiments have shown that is not possible. So we can retrain our control algorithm. We can explore neuroplasticity. Other applications might be the system can be used and apply steer torque perturbation in order to identify the properties of the rider arms, and this is something that I have also tried in practice.
Okay, some of these might be promising for safety, and some of them I think many people would advise against, but maybe we can talk about that at some point in the future. My second question was that you concluded there was no difference in behavior with and without haptic feedback in chapter 5. This was discussed several times already. But so I would like to think with you, based on what did you conclude this? So I would argue that this is only a very limited explanation of human control behavior. You looked at group average variance accounted for, and group average relative time delay. But so I expect there might be other behavioral differences. For example, how did people ride their trajectories? So what's the variability in trajectory? How close did they get to the boundaries of the road? What was the impact of the perturbation on their trajectories? Did it become less or more? Perhaps even steering behavior. So in driving, we have something called reversal rates. And so that shows how many small corrections you make, and that actually says something about how easy it is for you to steer. Torques, upper body balancing. So there you go. So if you let me go, I think of many things to measure and look at. And so could you comment on such different evaluations of behavior?
Jorge Lindo Bonent, thank you for your question. So if I understand clearly, you want to point out why I have this conflict in my conclusions. So as I said before, there are mainly three conditions, so haptics on, haptics off, and in the simulation model, totally disconnected or feedback. As I said before, there is some still feedback perceived from the rider due to the inertial properties of the handlebars and frictional damping of the upper motor. So even though you cancel out the torque feedback that is coming from the front wheel and because of the bicycle dynamics, you have some perceived deformation, and this can be reduced by applying negative stiffness.
If I may interrupt you, my question is, did you look at different types of metrics? So did you observe body sway? Did you observe, did you record trajectories? Did you film that in any way? Do you have every other things to look at?
You can answer with a yes or no.
Objectively, no. Subjectively, from videos, I can see that there is upper body motions. And as I said before, this must be mathematically modeled to see if the roll displacements that we experience as an output of the model, why is the reason which they do not match with the actual responses.
That was much more than a yes and a no. In the interest of time, Professor Abink, are you satisfied with these answers?
Yes, I am. Thank you.
Okay, then I would like to give the floor to the co-promoter, Dr. Schwab. Yeah, you have to unmute yourself. Otherwise, we only see body language.
Yeah. Mr. Director, thank you very much. Well, George, it was great seeing all this work, and
exactly.
It was great to see all this work. I actually have one question on chapter 3, and it has already been addressed, I think, previously by one of the exam committee members. Chapter 3, I hear you right that the objective being the comfort. And that's one of the first statements in the introduction, that you look at the dynamic response because of the comfort. Now, later on, during this defense, you said, well, actually, I can use the data to improve the Cavalli-Whipple model and have a more compliant rider model on top of that. Because in real life, we observe that the rider is moving relative to the Can we use your data, or should we do more experiments to get a validated model? So can we use your data, the current data, to build that model, or do we use more experiments, and what will they look like?
Sir Herr Linder, promoter, thank you for your question. The answer is, in case you want to add a model of the rider, of the upper body motions of the rider, you can use the sway data in order, especially the C2 sternum transmissibility functions, to fit a model there and identify with system modification the stiffness and damping properties of the pendulum. But you need to be really careful, because I think regarding the pelvis dynamics, we need to maybe redo the experiments with EEG devices attached to the muscle of the rider to indicate where these high forces that we noticed in the lateral direction of the seat, how these forces are induced in the seat. So is this a dynamic contribution only of the legs and trunk, the postular dynamics, or is it like a combination of feet and also arms and also postular dynamics? So yes, if you want to add a simple model into your system, you can use the C2 sternum transmissibility functions. Maybe it's wise to combine them with a roll data, so redo the experiments by rolling the platform and not only laterally moving the platform, but I guess it will give you a good approximations of the parameters.
Dr. Schwab, are you satisfied with this answer?
No, not really, Mr. Director, because I'm struggling with one problem. How about the relative rotation of the steering assembly with respect to the rear frame?
Candidate,
your whole setup.
Can you give a reply in one sentence?
Yes, I'm referring to the role stabilization. You are totally right. We need to imply stridor perturbation in order to model the stiffness and dynamic properties of the hands. So only for the role we can have a model attached to the head, to the existing bicycle model, but not for the hands of the rider.
Are you now satisfied, Dr. Schwab?
Yes, Mr. Director, I'm satisfied with the answer.
Fortunately. Thank you, Madam Beadle. I request the promovendus to go to the seat. The committee will withdraw for further deliberation in the committee room. The session is adjourned.
Once again, I would like to thank you that you are here. It really means something to me, and I really appreciate it. I think also after the Corona crisis, we can be positive about it. Thank you.
them otherwise?
Yes, sure.
And you don't have paronyms to help you, and you now have time to do so, and then you don't forget it.
Yes.
Okay.
I don't know, maybe my friend.